Thank you. Service will begin shortly. Please take your seats. Thank you.
When the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in. they crowned him. Oh, with the sun refused to shine. Oh, when the sun refused to shine. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number with the sun. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go. Oh, where the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in the number. Yeah.
I'm convinced that that is what it's going to be like in heaven. Yeah? A lot of joy, a lot of music, a lot of dancing. Dear family, friends, community members, and distinguished guests from out of town, welcome to the funeral for Foster Freeze. My name is Ben Pascal. I serve as the senior pastor here at the Presbyterian Church of Jackson Hole, where Lynn and Foster attend. And on behalf of our congregation, we welcome you. We hope you feel at home here today and that you experience the love and the grace of God, and may you sense the presence of Jesus in our midst. Let us now take a moment to center our hearts, silence our cell phones, as we enter into this sacred moment by giving thanks to God for Foster, this incredible man who touched all of our lives. Let us remember his life here on earth, and may we rest in the hope of his life everlasting, promised to us in Jesus Christ, our Lord. As we gather here today to celebrate the life of Foster, I want to acknowledge that it is so great to have you all here together, and that's what's so important, that we're together today. Lynn and family, we are gathered not only because we love and admire Foster, but we also care about you. So may you feel God's love today in the presence of all these dear friends and family. I first met Foster 20 years ago, and I always remember his warm smile, his generous heart, his brilliant mind, and the purpose and passion with which he lived his life. And Foster poured so much out into others, and he worked tirelessly to make our country and the world a better place. He never missed an opportunity to share God's love. And he was such an encourager, and he encouraged me on so many occasions. In this past year, he and Lynn partnered with our church to simply encourage and bless other people who were in need. It was so much fun. It was so much fun. He, I think like he did for so many of us, invited us into the joy of generosity. What a gift. May we acknowledge, be encouraged yet again today by Foster as we reflect on how he lived his life to the fullest for the sake of others and our Lord. Let's begin with a prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, Your word says that you were, you are, and you always will be. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You brought life to this world and everything in it. You breathed life into us through the power of your Spirit. And after you created all things, you said it was all very good. Thank you for life, O God. Please be with us this afternoon as we give thanks and celebrate the life of your good and faithful servant, Foster. We pray for your healing presence to comfort us as we grieve the loss of your son, and to us, a dear husband, father, grandfather, uncle, mentor, leader, role model, neighbor, and friend. May the tears, the sadness, the memories, the laughter, the songs, the words, and the silence all be avenues of your healing power to help us as we give you all thanks and praise for the life that you gave to Foster, which blessed us so deeply. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
As I'm sure you've all heard, and we'll hear more today, people tend to have all these amazing things to say about Pop. And whenever people start praising him at this or that dinner party, he would always lean in and complain that they always talk about how very handsome I am and how incredibly rich and successful I am, but never remember to say how humble I am. He brought me in close one day and told me one of his many little secrets, that the essence of making good jokes is in the unexpected, leading your audience one way and then whipping in some random direction to surprise everyone. He'd always mention how important it was to have all these excellent jokes because humor brings people together. And bringing people together was one of Pop's greatest passions. All of us cousins will never be able to forget his candles that he had a near religious fervor to bring at every dinner party. Passing them around and artfully positioning them under each person's face so that everyone could better see each other. He loved people so much that shepherding them around from event to event actually became quite the challenge of on-time delivery. He would just keep talking, making people feel appreciated despite our best efforts to get him on to the next event. I'll never grow tired of recalling all of our adventures. A year or two ago, we were in D.C. for the White House Christmas party, and I had grown out of all of my suits. We went to Brooks Brothers and found a pinstripe suit that to perfectly match his. Everyone found it hilarious that a 14-year-old was wearing a banker's suit. But I loved it because I was proud he wanted me to match him. Enough so that here I am wearing one today. His compliments and praise never ceased to lift me up, and there was nothing better as a kid than running up to his open embrace whenever we'd see him. Love you, Pop, and we'll miss you for sure. All right, we're gonna read a little one of Pop's favorite Bible verses here. Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Look to yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.
For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to see me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see thee hungry and feed thee, or thirsty and give thee drink? And when did we see thee a stranger and welcome thee, or naked and clothe thee? And when did we see thee sick or in prison and visit thee? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me. Even if you didn't agree with all of his views, nobody in this world can doubt that Foster was a man of the highest caliber. He changed the world forever with his kindness, love, and character. It was not just our family that lost a beloved grandfather, father, uncle, husband. It was to you all who lost a fountain of good, an impeccable friend, America who lost a true patriot, and God who lost a beacon of his hope and love to humanity. We all know that Pop is in heaven doing everything he did down here, making everyone's days a little brighter, smiles a little bigger, and burdens a little lighter. He taught me what it meant to be a better daughter, a better cousin, and a better person overall. He connected me with Jesus and God and all that I had to learn from them. Whatever he did not directly give me, he made possible through his gifts and advice. Even if a conversation began in tears, without fail, it ended in hugs and laughter. Even in his last few days, we giggled through our tears at his words and expressions. He loved our Grammy with every fiber of his being. As little girls, my sister and I would always say "ew" to each other when they'd kiss, talk about their ever-growing romance, and chew down the same spaghetti noodle at dinner and meet in the middle like Lady and the Tramp. I have never seen anyone love anybody like Foster and Lynn love one another. Even though he has left this physical existence, Foster will really never die. I see him every day in my mother's ability to help anyone through anything. I see him in the power behind my sister's passion for civil rights and my dad's laughter, jokes, and graciousness. I see the twinkle of his eyes in all of my awesome cousins and the love he had for the world and the beautiful woman that is my incredible, powerful grandmother. His legacy of love and acceptance and goodness will live on through all of us forever. As you lead the rest of your lives, I encourage you all to think of one thing Foster did for you. Not a material thing, like an action-packed hunting trip or a generous check. Something regular, like a smile or a joke or a pat on the back of confidence. Try to do this for the people that you see needing it, because he can't be here to support us like that anymore. I want to leave you all with a piece of advice Pop gave me every time we parted. In a time of turmoil and confusion and change, be a channel of God's love to others and his hands and feet in a hurting world. There is nothing on this earth that cannot be healed with love like this man gave.
Great men and women throughout history have left a shadow of influence behind that impacted the lives of millions of people for generations to come. And Foster is certainly one of those great men whose shadow will continue to impact all of our lives, our children's lives, our grandchildren's lives, and through the organizations that many of us represent, millions of other people, many that will never know his name, they'll be affected by his shadow of influence. The first time I met Foster and Lynn was in the Phoenix Convention Center. I was speaking to a large crowd there, and I was sharing the story of my daughter, Rachel, who was the first victim of the Columbine tragedy in 1999. It was a year later, and my wife and I had just started a nonprofit organization called Rachel's Challenge, which now is in schools around the world. And Foster and Lynn walked up to me and handed me a folded check. And, you know, I've had people hand me checks for $10, $20 before. But I wasn't expecting what I saw when I opened that check later, and I was stunned by the amount, and you could have knocked me over with a feather. But from that day until now, and throughout eternity, a bond of friendship was made between Foster and Lynn and Sandy and I, and we're so deeply grateful for all that they've done for our organization. With their help, we've been able to reach 30 million students in live settings, assemblies, trainings, rallies around the world with numerous speakers. And one of those assemblies was attended by a young girl by the name of Hope. This was 17 years ago. Hope walked into her school with no hope. She planned to commit suicide that day after school. She had a rope and pills waiting for her when she got home. But she went to an assembly, heard my daughter's story, went to a training, and it changed her life. She changed her mind about taking her own life. And today, 17 years later, she has children of her own that would not have been born, Lynn, except for you and Foster, because we were at that school because of your financial help. Michael and Timothy were two young men who walked into their school just a few years ago, planning to kill as many students as they could a week later. They had already borrowed guns from a friend who was older than them, didn't know what they were planning, and they had plans to outdo Columbine. But Michael and Timothy are alive today because they went to an assembly, went to a training, it changed their lives. And because of Foster's shadow of influence, they're alive today, and many of their potential victims are alive, and many of them have children that are alive. Foster was a great friend. He was a great man. He was a great philanthropist, a great influencer, but he was also a great man of God. And sometimes we reserve that for for bishops or pastors or evangelists or rabbis or priests. But God uses vessels that don't have theological training sometimes to do mighty works, and Foster was one of those. But I think Laura Ingram's son said it the best when he said, "Mama, he looks like a cowboy." And Foster was a true cowboy. Whether we were walking down the halls of Congress in Washington, D.C. with his hat on and his cowboy boots, or playing golf in Phoenix, or on a fishing trip in Mexico, when Foster walked in the room, you knew a cowboy was present when he was there. In the Old West, there were two compliments, the highest compliments that a cowboy could pay to a friend. And those two compliments were, "He'll do to ride the river with." And the other one was, "He sits tall in the saddle." And every one of Foster's outriders, all of us would agree with those two compliments. He would do to ride the river with, and he sat tall in the saddle. Psalm 91 says, "He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." Even though God is invisible, he casts a massive shadow throughout the universe. And his shadow represented three things: protection, provision, and purpose. Foster also cast a massive shadow. And those same three things apply to his shadow of influence. He had purpose to provide for those in need and to protect those who were brutalized or victimized. And a few days ago, I wrote a poem that I want to dedicate to you, Lynn. And it's called Foster's Shadow. Out of Rice Lake came a legend who was birthed by destiny. He's a man who loved America and helped to keep it free. He wore leather boots and cowboy hats and loved to tell us jokes. He was friends with global leaders and with all us common folks. He and Lynn became quite wealthy, but they used it for the good, helping victims and the needy in a way that Christians should. Foster gave to many causes, and his gifts were never small. He sat tall in the saddle, and his shadow touched us all. He would help a struggling waitress through her great financial strain. He would underwrite the victims of a massive hurricane. He supported acts of kindness and compassion in our schools. He gave freely to great ventures while avoiding greedy fools. Both Republicans and Democrats would come to love this guy, who stood firm in his convictions with a twinkle in his eye. Foster had his share of ups and downs, but never did he fall. He sat tall in the saddle, and his shadow touched us all. He loved his wife and family, and he loved his friends as well. And all of us have stories that we don't have time to tell. He'll always be remembered in our hearts and minds, but then someday we'll pass beyond the veil to greet him once again. He would do to ride the river with, as all the cowboys say. He walked humbly before his God through each and every day. Foster lived a life to fullest till he heard the master's call. He sat tall in the saddle, and his shadow touched us all.
Sixes and sevens. running around, trying everything new, but nothing.
If there's one thing I've learned, and Kata reminded me of that again today, is never come to an event for Foster without bringing your ambiance kit. Okay. Now you'll see that softer light on my face. Dearest Lynn and family, Reverend clergy, and friends of Foster, we're gathered here because of one man, a man known personally to most of us, known only by reputation to even more, a man loved by many, scorned by others, a man known for his great compassion and incredible sacrificial love. That man, of course, is Jesus of Nazareth. We are here in this church because Jesus died for our sins, rose from the dead to give us hope of everlasting joy with him in heaven. Foster believed that. But a few weeks ago, as he was facing the end, he shared that he wasn't 100% convinced. He had doubts. Don't we all? If each of us believed 100% and had absolutely no doubt of the cross and resurrection, we would likely not be living the lives we're living today. Foster then quickly quipped that he was around 90%. But like everything else, Foster went all in on that 90%. For the 28 years I knew him, he passionately proclaimed the gospel. Who could forget his mealtime blessing, thanking God for us starting every day anew because Jesus forgives us for all the dumb things we did yesterday. But the tributes to Foster have not mentioned him preaching the gospel. They acclaimed him because he lived the gospel. Foster was one of the greatest investors of his generation and amassed incredible wealth using the strategy of investing in people, not products. But the money did not bring happiness. Halfway through his life, he found true joy, as he said, when I accepted Jesus as the chairman of the board of my life. He realized that his talent and the riches that came from it were a gift from God, and he should use those gifts to be a better husband, a better father, and God's hands and feet in a hurting world. We know from his frequent boasts about the talents and accomplishment of his children and grandchildren that Foster deeply loved his family and believed and invested in their dreams, like Steve and Polly's Jackson Hole Classical Academy. But remarkably, Foster extended his care and concern to his friends, the politician, the conservative activist, the humanitarian, and yes, the waitress and the welder. I'm sure in some way he encouraged you and maybe even invested in your dreams. He saw the good in you that you didn't even see and believed in you even when you doubted yourself. And what a difference that made with Tucker and Neil with the Daily Caller and Mark Meckler with the Tea Party movement and Ethan Steinberg, the waiter turned investment manager, and so many, many more, including me and my family. In 1993, I was one of 10 Senate candidates who spoke to a posse of Republican donors in D.C., and after my talk, this guy came up to me, and we instantly became friends. I never asked why he picked me that day. Maybe he saw in me something of himself at that age, raw, ambitious, driven, but an obvious need of a little seasoning. And did he ever season? Being a friend of Foster's is like getting a PhD in friendship. No one did friendship better than Foster Freeze. He helped me get elected, but that was just the beginning. In 1996, thanks in part to Foster's encouragement, I took my first foray into pro-life politics by managing the partial birth abortion bill, and I hashed up a $1 million ad campaign to try to influence Senate votes. My first fundraising call was to Foster. I started making my pitch, and Foster asked me if he could put me on speaker for Lynn to listen. When I finished, he asked if I could hold a minute. He returned and said, Lynn and I will donate $250,000. That was an amazing gift, but it was also an important lesson for me about Foster. Foster was not a Lone Ranger. He was the public face of a couple where each brought essential elements that led to their success. And importantly, Foster knew it and loved Lynn for it. If you have any doubt about Lynn carrying on their legacy, you should have seen Lynn deliver his message and interact with voters during the governor's race. Foster was a great candidate, but with all due respect, Governor, had Lynn run, she would have won that race. C.S. Lewis said, a friend is someone who knows the song in your heart and can sing it back to you when you've forgotten the words. Lynn knows Foster's song in his heart, because Lynn was the beautiful music to that song. Karen and I were blessed to have these soulmates as true friends during our years in the Senate. You know, it's an axiom in politics that a politician learns his true friend after he loses an election. How about losing an election by 18 points and then announcing running for president? In 2012, I was at the bottom of the field, a big field, hosting events with only a handful of people, barely qualifying for every debate, where I got fewer questions than the cameraman. Foster and Lynn were the first to donate. But as the campaign wore on, my pal knew we needed something more than money. So in the months leading up to the Iowa caucuses, Foster was at my side at every debate, forum, or big speech to encourage me, to give me a high-profile surrogate, and make me laugh. I was the conservative warrior in the race, but Foster and my wife Karen constantly chastised me to become the happy warrior. In the final weeks before the caucus, the happy warrior started to gain traction. But we didn't have money to run any television ads, and thus I had really no chance of winning. I'll never forget working a breakfast crowd at a diner a couple of weeks before the caucus, and a guy told me that he had just seen my ad on television. Foster's ads helped me go from 7% to winning the Iowa caucus. Who invests money in a candidate at 7% a few weeks before an election? A true believer and a true friend. We didn't win the nomination, but Foster was rightly recognized as the one donor with the courage to support the conservative cause and stand up to the establishment. Now, every conservative wanted Foster to do for them or their project what he had done for us. Instead of being overwhelmed by the onslaught, Foster seized the opportunity to restore the goodness of America by launching and supporting hundreds of candidates and organizations to fight for the values that made our country great. That twinkle in those steel blue eyes would blind you when he talked about great projects like ACE scholarships or a candidate that he was going to help save America, like you, Christy, and you, Mike. But as years passed, Foster grew more concerned about America's future. On his last fishing trip, we sat on the boat, and he shared his frustration that he wasn't succeeding in so many important things in his life. He said he had so much more to do, so many balls in the air, but not enough points on the board at a time when America really needed him. Just a few weeks ago, while getting an infusion to keep him alive, he reiterated this frustration, and in typical Foster fashion, explained one of the reasons for his failure. He said, "Rick, I was just diagnosed with stage 4 procrastination." In spite of that diagnosis, a few weeks ago, Foster and Lynn established the Foster's Outriders Foundation to make sure that his family and friends keep his dreams for America alive. It should come as no surprise that the Master of Friendship included in the Outriders' mission statement a requirement to continue his hunting and fishing trips, to gather his pals, civic community, and media leaders, together with his family, to collaborate on projects, start and build friendships, and of course, share meals with only one person talking at a time. Outriders and the Lynn and Foster Freeze Foundation will be another part of Foster's legacy as one of the greatest Americans of his generation. But Foster would insist that his greatest legacy will be his investment in the people that God put in his path, that he was a follower of Jesus who tried his best to love God and love his neighbor as himself and make God and his friends laugh while doing it. Well done, my good and faithful servant.
God. When I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hand made, I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son, not sparing, he sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Matt Clark, and on behalf of my mother, Tracy, and our family from Kennett Square, I'd like to thank all of you for coming here today. I'd like to start with a passage from Philippians 4. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near.
Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, whatever is deserving of praise, dwell on these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Well, I do not know a lot of you that are in this room today, but one thing that I think we can all agree about with my grandfather was that the thing that he would want to be remembered by probably the most was how much he could make an entire room smile when he stepped in. So I would like to share with you a story that makes me smile every time I retell it. So July 6th, 2019, I was here in Jackson with him. We were embarking on one of our revered golf trips. And the first day had gone great. And the second day, we woke up. It was a beautiful day in the morning. And we went out to go golfing with Pop's longtime caddy, Andrew Heady. Now, we headed over to Teton Pines, and we started golfing. And about an hour into the round, it started to rain. And we decided, it's best to head in. When we got into the clubhouse, it had started snowing, possibly 40 mile an hour winds and everything, and we didn't see where my grandfather was, so we're thinking, where is he? And we went up to the bag boy, and we asked him if he had seen my grandfather, and he was freaking out, because he was from San Diego. He didn't even know what rain was, let alone snow. Anyways, we headed in, and it was just me and Andrew, and we got a burger. We each got a burger, and, we were with Pop, so no questions asked there. It was just kind of eat, leave, we aren't going to ask anything about that. But when we headed back out onto the course after it stopped raining, we get out to the hole, and right behind these two massive pine trees, we see Pop and his golf cart tilted 45 degrees over to the side, just pecking on his phone, dictating an email. And we get there, and he's like, oh, where'd you guys even go? And it had been an hour and 45 minutes at that time. And so, we just headed on like absolutely nothing had happened. And I just look back at these times with my grandfather. And it's just, I know he believed a lot in me and what I could do with the game. And I know that he always wanted to be someone who would cheer up the room. So, I just wanted to take a moment to recognize my grandfather in the way that, through my personal experience, I think he would want to be remembered.
I don't know how I'll follow that, but when I think of my grandfather, I think of many different things. Him teaching me gin rummy on a sunny afternoon, or his endless number of jokes that he just seemed to keep pulling out from somewhere. But as I'm sure many others in this room today can attest to, when I think of my grandfather, I think of him as the embodiment and realization of ambition, of personal ambition. And the remarkable thing is that many of the most incredible opportunities that I've had in my life, and I'm sure many of you here today have also had, are a direct result of his hard work and the fulfillment of that ambition and his dreams, and that is something that I am forever grateful for. So I want to thank you all again for coming today and honoring his memory.
here. Okay, there we go. Maybe the eyes are fading. I might not be able to use that. So I remember as a kid loading up all four of us, Carrie, Tracy, Mike, Mom and Dad, a cooler full of bologna sandwiches and peanut butter and jelly and carrots and grapes for our 22-hour straight-through drive from Wilmington, Delaware to Wisconsin, where we would see Grandma and Grandpa Freeze, my dad's older brother Herm, and his wife Judy, and their four kids, Greg, Lisa, Cindy, and Jane, who are roughly the same ages as we were. And, you know, I think every other year, when he's 20 minutes from the ramp, from the cottage on the lake where we would all meet, he would stop at a payphone, remember those? Everybody? And call and say, gee, you know, we're in Chicago and the transmission is blown and I think it's going to take a couple days. We're probably going to have to turn around and drive back. And so I'm real sorry. It just looks like this year's not going to work out. And then we would show up 10 minutes later. And I think he did that more than once. It's the craziest thing. So let's see. There's... at a time like that, and times that maybe some of you have been with him, let's paint the scene. The fish were biting, and we've cooked them all up, fried them, and out on the dock, and the sun's going down. He had this phrase that he would say, right? Did anybody remember this? This is living. Anybody else? If you were on a hunt with him or a fishing trip, that was something you would have heard now and then. I remembered another trip that we took. We were preparing to do another long drive to Florida, where to fit the budget those days, we were going to be in a tent. But the six of us. But we were going to go out on a boat to snorkel for the first time on a reef and see the fish. We'd never done that. And my dad had been taking scuba lessons at the YMCA every Tuesday for months and months. And it was the night we knew he had to go somewhere else for his certification dive. We waited up late. He came home with this cornucopia of lobster and crab and clams, as if he had just gotten that diving. And we're saying, wow, can dad save us a ton of money by just going and getting seafood every day when he dives? And then I noticed that the crabs had already been cooked in Old Bay spice. And so that kind of... So Dad had, in addition to that, his playful sense of humor went beyond reciting jokes. He had this wiring for these incredibly bizarre one-liners on the spot. So I'm going to share three of those with you. I often attended with him gatherings of very serious conservatives working on great ideas to save the country. And he was once asked by one, so Foster, how did you meet this other notable conservative with great thoughts and ideas? He says, eHarmony.com. As another one that's a little even stranger, I guess. As the firm grew and finances allowed, we had a beach house in Stone Harbor, and there was this summer when a couple dolphins were washing up on the beach, and we didn't know, you know, was it a virus, was it pollution, but environmentalism was just in the air everywhere. And sure enough, to our door came a fellow raising money for Greenpeace, and he stepped inside and he gives his little spiel and he said, we've really got to save the whales. And Stoneface, I hate whales. Now my favorite one was walking down an aisle at, it's probably the Broadmoor, you know, this fancy big conference center, carpeting little velvet settees along the way. It's myself in a suit with my mom and my dad, and along the other way comes this cute little lady with white hair tucked under a cute hat and a clutch bag, and she's coming slower and slower. And she says, excuse me, sir, do you have the time? And with my mom right there, he says, got lots of time. What do you have in mind? And she sat down on the couch, and I thought she was going to collapse. Her belly was just going crazy. Okay. So, okay, I got to censor. I got to, you know, not censor, but cut. What's going on here? So I want to thank you, Dad. You equipped me with some great knowledge. I'm going to skip the investment stuff. I'm going to say I tagged along with him to endless political fundraisers and understood the real importance of having the right people in the position. But I also got a real sense that it also depends what they accomplish and what they do, and that led me to get involved in some policy work that has been the most rewarding experience of my life, and that only could have happened through him. So the other thing to thank him for are the people. Those of you that I've gotten to know in more than a passing way, you know that you've had an effect on my life, and I care a lot about all of you. And then some others who he's now with, got to know John Walton, who I had the privilege of working with on education policy, and Andrew Breitbart, who is just a crazy visionary. And one man very special to me, Baron Stieg Rommel, the chairman of the Nobel Foundation. The Nobel Foundation was his very first client. And every April, Stieg would come for his investment review. And when I was 7, 8, 9, 10, 15, he always happened to be there when it was my birthday. And I'm blowing out the candles. And here's this guy seeing me every year along the way. And we developed quite a relationship through that. And that was a treasured opportunity. So Dad, you lived a full life. You were guided by principles. You helped others. You never stopped trying to make a difference. You did what you could with what you were given. And I'll do my best to do the same.
Please join me and help me do this by taking 3 deep breaths. Larger than life, a force, walking charisma, like a movie star, captivating, charming, big-hearted, a piece of work. These are just some of the words people use when referring to my dad. I worked with Dad for several years and had the privilege of attending his last American Electronics Association Investors Conference with him. He wanted to show me the ropes. In just one day, we met with 12 management teams and devoured the O'Neill charts on each company together. By the end of the day, I would have been hard-pressed to remember the names of all the companies without my notes. Meanwhile, my dad, with lightning speed recall, could tell me what the third company we met with was going to do in dollars and cents per share in the second and third quarter of the coming year. He was a force. We all know he loved to talk and tell stories and jokes, but in that environment, he was a charisma memory machine. He never front-loaded his questions with a whole bunch of talking to demonstrate his knowledge. He taught his analysts not to do this and not to waste people's time. Efficiency was his passion, and when coupled with performing in front of people or performing in the markets, he was a master. Our time working together solidified a mutual respect and special bond. One of the things my parents have modeled for me in not just their words, but also their behavior and actions, is gratitude. Gratitude for the people that truly make this world work. Whenever they held an event, my dad would ask the entire kitchen staff to come and receive the crowd's applause and praise. I know my dad's heart was hearing the names of the people who have made his life work over all these years. Debbie, Cindy, Judy, Derek, Maggie, Rebecca, Jamie, Craig, Chuck, Bailey, Diana, Joanne, Matthew, people that have worked at the Mariposa, and the most recent dynamic trio of Caroline, Stephen, and Max. To all of you, thank you. And of course, the woman beside the man, my mom, AKA Linner, Thumper, Mamacita, and Grammy. For most of my life, I remember my dad responding this way, even on bad days, when people asked him how he was doing. Any better, I'd be an astronaut. I always found that response quirky, and people often looked confused upon hearing it. But in this moment, I get it, and I already miss it. Let's try that, shall we? In a little call and response right now, I'm going to ask you how you're doing today, and you respond, channeling your best Foster enthusiasm. Any better, I'd be an astronaut. How are you doing today?
Any better, I'd be an astronaut.
You are a piece of work, and I love you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. First of all, I did not know Uncle Foster. I've heard that that's the affectionate name that he has given. But after being here this morning, I feel like I know him personally. And the one thing I hear is there's so much love in this room. And if you feel the love, why don't we celebrate the spirit of Foster right now by giving them the biggest applause and say, you did a great job. You're awesome, man. You rock. Foster would be just like, yeah. So, we're gonna sing a song that everybody probably knows. You can sing along with us. We're from Chicago, so we're just here and you can start playing the track. And you all can sing along with us. And when we get to praise God, if you wanna get up and wave your hand, we're gonna do that in honor of Foster today. Can we turn it up just a little bit? Sing along with it. I think y'all started in the wrong place. Can we start a little? I don't know what happened.
God when we come in. Praise God, everybody, praise God. We turn the track up, please.
Praise God.
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 I guess wow would be the word we need to use for that. What an amazing outpouring of love, devotion. This is round two, in case some of you guys don't know. This is round two of Foster's farewell celebration. And I can say we're getting close to celebrating today. It feels good in here. I just want to thank you all for your outpouring of love to the Freeze family. We know they deserve it. Everyone here knew that Foster desired to make people better. No matter who you were, it was as though he was investing in your life, even if he's just met you. Whether it was an employee that he was running you down, or one of us at the dinner table throwing dinner rolls at our heads because we were talking out of turn. And those he mentored from afar. I know one day I was riding with Foster, and it was one of my most fond memories of hanging with him. Anytime it just got to be him and I, was just, I was 10 feet tall. And we were hanging out on the golf course, and you know, people always talk about Foster and his ability to pick stocks, and we all know he was the best at that. And so I sat there while he was just downloading all these nuggets of information and wisdom to me, and I'm so thankful for all these times. And I said, Foster, you know, people often, you know, remark that you're really good at picking stocks. I said, but after hanging out with you for about the last 10, 15 years, boy, you can pick people. And he just pauses for a minute and he lights up. He says, boy, can I pick them. Boy, I can pick them. I remember it was maybe 8, 10 years ago. He calls me up and he was more excited than I had heard him in past times. And he says, oh, you got to come out here and you got to meet this young guy. And I said, okay, Foster. He said, bring some young people with you. You got to come meet this young guy. And I had no idea. But when Foster Freeze calls me, I'm there. And I'm not ashamed to say that. There's not much in this world I would not cancel to go be with my friend Foster. And I walk into this dining room out at Estancia, and I walk in there, and I see this skinny little kid sitting at the table with a suit on at least 3 sizes too big. And he goes, this is my friend here, boy. He's going to be something big. His name's Charlie Kirk. And I say, this kid? Charlie Kirk is today one of my greatest heroes. He is one of the greatest people I know. Yeah. Looking around this room, boy, could he pick him. Boy, could he pick him. And I realized in that moment, I'm one of his picks. I'm somebody that Foster Freeze has decided to surround himself with. What a great honor. One of the greatest joys of my life. I was palling around with Foster Freeze. His best pick by far, I know I don't have to tell you this, his best pick by far was the Lord Jesus Christ. And he never passed up an opportunity to tell people what Jesus Christ meant to him. Foster Freeze was my very good friend. And there's no doubt in my mind he's standing there with Jesus Christ today. And as Norton Rainey reminded us yesterday, he's probably the first person in heaven that came with an improvement list. You're the chairman, Jesus. These are just ideas. I know we all appreciate that. I mentioned yesterday that I just hope they have round tables or we're really gonna have problems. I remember just like so many of us, the first time going out with Foster, and you know, this guy comes out and he's gotta have the round table and he makes the restaurant move us all the way to the other side in this little bitty corner when we had a private dining room, and I'm thinking, what kind of guy is this? And my wife keep giving those looks. You know, husbands and wives, we have those looks. You can look at each other and just kind of like, what's going on here? He pulls out the candles and he sits them around and we're like, oh man, we're in trouble. And then as this wealthy, affluent, famous man begins to position those candles around the table, it dawns on me, this guy cares about these people. This guy cares. We all know it. He understood the importance of connecting with his fellow man, of caring for his fellow man, even carrying his fellow man's burdens. This is who Foster Freese was. See, there were no big and small people at Foster's table, whether it was hunting or fishing or wherever we were. We were all equals. There were no important and unimportant, no rich and poor. Foster cared for everyone equally, and that amazed me every single time I witnessed it, that there were no differentiation between folks. Thinking back, he's the best guy I've ever known, and somebody who was raised without parents, I'm always on the lookout for what I would consider model parents being, and I know that the 20 years I've gotten to know this man, you guys are so blessed and fortunate. Talk about humility. I know he used to joke about it, but that was a humble man. All of us can attest to that. But he's also a kind man, and he was also a man of extraordinary generosity. Every time he was around people, he was giving himself away, or he was giving his money away. It brings to mind a passage from the book of Matthew when this young man ran up to Jesus and he says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, you know the commandments, just follow them, you'll be fine. And the young man said something extremely astonishing. He goes, oh, I've kept all those since I was a young boy. I mean, none of us can say that, including Foster. And he said, well, there's one thing you lack. Go and sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and then come and follow me. See, the man didn't have a problem that we think. He had a money problem. Money owned the man. The man didn't own the money. Scripture tells us that the man hung his head and went away very sad after hearing that, because the money owned him. Jesus turned to his apostles and he said, listen, I want you to know something. It is really, really hard for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. I want you to know Foster Freese made it look easy. If you're ever at a loss of wondering what it looks like to make it through, look to Foster Freese. Even the way this guy left the planet makes us all just sit back and reflect on our lives and think about how we would like to meet our end. I told yesterday of how Lynn requested that I come over and pray with Foster, and I'm so glad that I happened to be just around the corner at the time, or I would not have made it. And I arrived there, and it was a lot like today. There was a sense of sadness, but there was an overwhelming sense of hope, especially for those of us that know that we're going to be with Foster before you know it. I walked in, and there this man was in his sickly state, but still brightening up the room. Here he was with all of his loved ones around him, his beautiful grandchildren, his closest family. And as I was led into the room to pray for my friend, I knelt down and I began to pray. And while I prayed for my friend, he left the planet. And I thought to myself, man, did he plan that? Did he just say, okay, because you know, Foster was always looking out for others, because it was never about him. And I think that maybe he wanted his family to just be there and just be blessed as he left the planet. It'll always be one of the greatest honors of my life. Thank you for that call, Lynn. Thank you for wanting me there. I thought, what better way to go meet Jesus than to be surrounded by the people you love the most, even better, people that love you. I don't have to tell any of you that know Foster how much he loved his family. And it's like I can hear him through these last days speaking to me, this is so hard. He goes, oh, Samson, it's so much better than we ever imagined. And I'm going to save you a seat. Mysteries of life and death are known to Foster. We have death because we live in a broken, fallen world full of sickness and disease, and death comes for us all. The mystery of life was revealed to Foster as well, but he already knew it. The mystery of life is to know Jesus Christ and to make him known. And any of you that have ever been part of any of his philanthropic efforts, giving away all his money, you've heard the speech. I made Jesus the chairman of the board of my life a long time ago. This money belongs to Jesus. If you want to thank somebody, thank him. If the money belonged to me, you wouldn't get one red cent. And every time we would just laugh, but he meant it. Foster knew where he was going when this life was done. We often talked about these things. I know I think of the book of John, chapter 14, when Jesus is telling his boys that he's about to go, and they're getting upset and troubled, and he says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. If it wasn't so, I wouldn't tell you. But I'm going there to prepare a place for you, and when I do, I'm going to come back and get you so that you can be with me where I am. You know where I'm going. His apostles befuddled. We don't know where you're going. How can we get there? He says, I am the way. And Foster knew that way. Jesus said, I am the truth. And Foster Freese knew that truth. He said, I am the life. And today, our friend Foster is experiencing that eternal life, that life beyond all other things. And I'm compelled to share with you some of the greatest nuggets of wisdom Foster ever gave me. And there are three rules that he gave me to live by. And he said, Samson, I don't know, did he point his finger at you guys too? All my memories, he's like, Samson. And he said, here's the rules to live by. If you do this, you'll do well. He says, number one, everything in moderation. Don't overdo it. I said, all right. Number two, you got to stay connected with young folks. You got to have some young folks around you to keep you grounded. I said, okay, it's good. Number three, he said, plan something for tomorrow exciting enough it's going to get you out of bed like that. What great advice. And then he would do the lean in. And I love the Foster Freese lean in. It's when he only wanted you to hear what he was about to say. And he'd lean in and he'd go, and Samson, number four, you got to check who's around before you say it because some people might get upset. Number four, pray you got good genetics because there's nothing you can do to change that. Is that all right? All right. If Foster sent us a message today, he'd say, yeah, everything in moderation, no doubt. Keep those young folks around you, no doubt. Definitely plan something for tomorrow exciting enough to get you out of bed. I can't tell you how many days that's gotten me up. And number four, I can see him now leaning in. It wouldn't be a punchline. Number four, he would say, Samson, make sure Jesus Christ is the chairman of your board. You'll be glad you did. You'll be glad you did. Foster, we salute you, my friend. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. You are the Lord of life. We praise you that we're made in your image, reflecting your truth and your light. Thank you for this life of our friend Foster Freese. Thank you for the love that you've shown him and the love that he's shown us. Can't wait to be with him. We thank you that we're going to share with all your people in a world remade, with no sin and no pain and no death. And we long to see you face to face and be reunited with our friend Foster. In Jesus Christ's mighty, mighty name, all God's children said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. At this time, I'd like to introduce the Honorable Vice President Mike Pence and the Honorable Governor Mark Gordon to present the flag to the Freese family.
Lynn, members of the Freeze family, distinguished guests, Mr. Vice President, Governor Noem, even you, Mr. Santorum. Welcome to God's country. And Wyoming truly is God's country, because can anybody doubt this is the day God has made? Lynn, from a grateful state, I have this flag that was flown on the 27th over the Capitol. It has been an honor to get to know you and to get to know Foster. And just a brief comment. Lynn went through all of those wonderful debates that we had all over the state, hundreds and hundreds of them. And, you know, I also had a secret weapon in Jenny over there. I don't know if you had a chance to share each other's joy on all of those debates every day. But I will say at the end, there was one really prophetic question which came up, and somebody said, so, for each of the candidates, what is it that you will most miss about running for governor? And one of the other candidates said, I wish I could say Foster's jokes. But when I think about Wyoming and I think about what both of you have done for our state, every Wyoming citizen appreciates it. It is amazing, the contribution that the Freezes have made to Wyoming. For those of us that rodeoed, there's a great prayer, and I know, Christy, you know this prayer. I won't say the whole thing. There are two stanzas that really remind me of Foster. Let me be easy on the man that's down, square and generous with all. I'm careless, Lord, sometimes when I'm in town, but never let him say I'm mean or small. Make me as big and open as the plains, as honest as a horse between my knees, clean as the wind that blows behind the reins, and free as the hawk that circles down the breeze. That reminds me so much of Foster. Thank you, Foster, for your friendship. Brief though it was, I've learned so much. God bless. Thank you, Lynn.
It's deeply humbling to be with you today. Governor, thank you for those words to the governors who are here. Secretary Carson, Senator Santorum, distinguished leaders and friends, and especially to Lynn and the Freeze family. Karen and I want to extend our deepest sympathies to you and your loss. The Bible tells us that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and that will be our prayer for you in the days that lie ahead. This has been a joyous celebration, and the words spoken from this podium from beginning to end have been a blessing, I know, to all of our hearts. I had a pastor tell me once that everybody's under-encouraged. That was true unless you were with Foster Freeze. I look around the room and I know from his family, those of us that benefited by his friendship, his support meant a great deal. His encouragement meant more. And as has been said, it wasn't just to the people that you saw on television or in the newspaper. It was to everybody. I'll never forget the time he and I had become acquainted when I was a member of Congress, a backbencher. He took an interest in me for reasons that are still a mystery to me. But after I became governor of Indiana, he was visiting Indiana. So I took my 14-year-old son, a big floppy head of hair, undisciplined kid, took him to a fundraiser, and I thought I would impress my son with how much people were impressed with me. I figured now that I was governor, I Foster would take a passionate interest in me. So I walked my 14-year-old son over to him, and there in the cowboy hat, and I said, "Michael, this is Foster Freeze." And Foster completely ignored me. But he trained like a laser on my boy. And he said, "Tell me about you." And Michael said rather shyly that he wanted to be a pilot. He wanted to serve in the military. And he listened intently and asked him questions. And then at the end of the conversation, as I've shared with others over the years, he looked at that floppy-headed 14-year-old boy and he said, "Son, you've got the future written all over your face." And Michael's big brown eyes were wide. And he's never forgotten that moment. Right now, that boy is a Marine Corps pilot serving overseas in the service of our nation. I tell that story just because I think it's typical of the man that we remember today, the man that's been spoken about here today. And the wonderful wife and partner and family that was alongside that made it possible to and shared him with our country and with our families. And so I'm here like all of you just simply to pay a debt of gratitude. First, just as a dad and as a friend. But also in what was my former capacity, I shall take the honor. On behalf of a grateful nation. When word that Abner had passed, King David said, the Bible records, "Do you not know that this day a prince and a great man has fallen in Israel?" People have rightly remembered his humor and his humility. Foster Freeze was a great man who embodied the American dream and his dedication to faith and freedom impacted millions of people across this country, and his legacy will be a stronger, freer, and more prosperous America. So help us, God. So on behalf of a grateful nation and the millions of lives he touched, past, present, and future, Lynn, it's my great honor to present you this American flag from the heart of that grateful nation. God bless you.
Just a couple of announcements as you leave today. There's a reception up at Diamond Cross Ranch up in Moran. It's about an hour drive north at 5 p.m. There's dinner, drinks, music. There will be buses right out here in the parking lot for anyone who needs transportation. We're asking if you're a local, please drive your own car to save room for our out-of-town guests to take the bus. There's also two guest books and baskets right outside that you can put cards in and sign the basket. Hear this benediction. I know one of Foster's favorite Bible verses was Galatians 6:2. It was one he used as a model for blessing others, and I think he would want us to be sent out of this place with these words turned into action. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. My friends, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Yippee.